Jokar Tsarnaev is found guilty in the Boston Marathon bombing trial, a federal jury returning its verdict after 11 hours of deliberations, convicting Tsarnaev on all 30 counts in the case, including using weapons of mass destruction. 17 of those counts carry the possibility of the death penalty. The April 2013 bombings near the marathon finish line killed 3 people and injured 260 others. The jury also convicting him in the death of a 4th person who was killed during an intense manhunt after the bombings. Joining us now to discuss is Harvard Law School's Ron Sullivan. Welcome to you, Ron.
Thank you very much. From
the onset of this trial, the defense admitted Tsarnaev's culpability, but argued that his older brother was really the mastermind. So did any part of the jury's decision come in as a surprise to you?
No, this was no surprise at all. This was a rare case when in the opening statement, the defense admitted to liability. So from the very beginning, they were trying this case with an eye toward the next phase, which is the punishment phase.
Okay, so the second phase of this trial could begin early next week. The same jury is going to consider whether he should be sentenced to life or death and prison. What will those 7 men and women, or the 7 women and 5 men, need to do to justify the death penalty?
Well, the Supreme Court has told us that the jury has to weigh aggravating circumstances versus mitigating circumstances. And there's a pretty well-defined list of the sorts of things that constitute aggravating versus mitigating factors. And the jury will decide whether the mitigating factors outweigh the aggregating factors. And if so, then Mr. Tsarnaev will get life in prison. If the opposite is true, then they'll sentence him to death.
Okay, so, but it's important to note that it only takes one juror to disagree for the sentence to become life without the possibility of parole. What does the prosecution need to do to prove to these jurors that Tsarnaev deserves to be put to death?
Well, the prosecution will try to show that this is an absolutely heinous, premeditated crime. So the death penalty is reserved for the worst of the worst sorts of crimes. And the prosecution is going to argue that the death penalty, if any case deserves a death penalty, it's this case. So they're going to look at the jury and say, you swore to uphold the law. The law says that under appropriate circumstances, you will and should sentence someone to death. This is the ideal case for that sort of ruling. So that's how the prosecution is going to approach it.
Of course, his lawyer is Judy Clark. She's one of the leading defense attorneys known for representing high-profile defendants, including Susan Smith and Ted Kaczynski. So her strategy has been to convince the jury to spare him of capital punishment by arguing that he was controlled by his domineering older brother. Will she change her strategy at all? And how is she going to explain the video where you see Jokar planting a backpack bomb near the marathon finish line?
Well, to the first part of your question, no, she's not going to change her strategy at all. From the very beginning, it's been one to show that although he's liable for the crime, his degree of culpability is significantly less than his older brother. So she's been doing, and she's an excellent, top-notch attorney, by the way, as you mentioned. But her strategy from the very beginning has been what people in the industry call a slow plea. In other words, she's never contested the underlying factual predicates, but what she has been doing is laying the groundwork for the mitigating factors. So she's going to stand up next week in front of the jury and, as you point out, argue that the younger brother, Jokar, was basically acting at the behest of his older brother. Now, there are things and evidence that contraindicate this. The video is one thing, but she'll deal with it. She'll simply say, ladies and gentlemen, once you're under the spell of someone like the older brother, once you're under that kind of spell, once you're conditioned to do whatever he says, when he says to do it, then you become compliant. And that's all Mr. Tsarnaev did. He just became compliant and followed what his brother said to do.
Professor Sullivan, you're there in Massachusetts. How does this play out in a place like Massachusetts where the death penalty is not very popular, considering the politics and the prominence of the Roman Catholic Church?
Well, that's a great question. It's a very curious tension here. So Most people who are against the death penalty, when asked if a family member was killed or some close loved one was killed, would you recommend death? And many people who are generally against the death penalty, when it comes close to home, then they rethink that position. So here you have a jurisdiction that has a strong and long history of anti-death penalty sentiment. However, you also now have a citizenry that was very harshly impacted by this crime. So here you're going to have a tension. People felt this crime in a deep way, such as the nature of terrorism. It makes people afraid. Mm-hmm. It terrorizes people. People had relatives, extended family, friends, loved ones, friends of friends, who were impacted. Everyone was impacted by the shelter in place. So here you have a situation where you have a community that was deeply impacted by this case. So it'll be curious to see what happens. Do the general anti-death penalty sentiments prevail, or is it the sort of case where the closeness of the crime prevails and argues in favor of the death penalty?
And there in Boston, what is the feeling and the emotion and the spirit right now in the air as they're heading into the Boston Marathon again?
Well, Boston strong, my friend. People are resilient here. So I think people see this, and as we're coming to the marathon, see this as an expression of the resiliency of the people of Boston. So it's going to be a hugely well-attended event. The crowds, again, this year will be large as they were last year, the year directly preceding. The year directly following, I should say, the bombing. So I think you're going to see big crowds, a lot of enthusiasm, but people will take a minute to reflect on the tragedy.
Okay, Ron Sullivan, thank you very much for that analysis. We appreciate it.
Take care.